We titled this program Purpose in Sight, and with good reason. This club, like Lions clubs the world over, is concerned with eye conservation. Jim Gerba of Skaneateles is head of the Central New York Eye Bank. It's a time-consuming job, but as a Lions Club volunteer, Jim does it willingly. He explained to Gene Doherty how Lions first became involved in the sight-saving project.
Lions International started back in about 1929. They had Miss Helen Keller, who was deaf, dumb, and blind. And at that time, she was invited to speak at the International Convention. And after hearing her talk, they went and started one of the major projects of Lions International, Sight Conservation of the Blind, helping the blind throughout the world. And since that time, this has been the major project.
I know that one of the other things that you emphasize is education, or people protecting their own eyes.
Well, we do have a speakers program. We have an educational film, which naturally we try to educate the general public as to the great need for eye tissue. Not along with that, there is a great need for research. We have a number of diseases like glaucoma, cataracts, and they are yet to be found why people do have glaucoma, why people do have cataracts. And so many people are being affected by it. And I'm sure that the Lions are playing a major role in having the glaucoma screening programs in their areas to try to detect some of these people who make themselves available.
The Lions Club projects, as you can see, are multifaceted. This is Dr. Frederick Stansbury. He is a Lion. He's also an ophthalmologist. Double reasons for being concerned in a sight-saving program. If Lions have their way, amblyopia will become a household word. Another term for that is lazy eye. And the medical world has discovered that if the condition is detected by the time a child is 7, it can be easily cured. But left unattended, the condition can lead to blindness. That's why Dr. Stansbury and Lions all over the country are involved in clinics for children as well as glaucoma clinics for adults. More than 4,000 people have been through the clinics served by the 63 clubs in District 2Y1. A second aim is to see that everyone who needs eye care gets it. Last year, Lions collected 19,000 used eyeglasses, provided funds for 41 eye examinations and for 12 delicate operations. But people are more interesting than statistics. Individuals matter most. This is Elmore Jenks, a teacher at Morrisville Eaton Central School and an active member of the Morrisville Lions Club. He knows firsthand the value of their projects. Elmore Jenks is particularly interested in youth work, and it's natural that he should be with 5 children of his own. This is Susan. She's 12 and will be starting 7th grade in the fall. We met 3 of the 4 Jenks boys the day we visited in Morrisville. The oldest, Philip, hadn't yet returned from Eastern Baptist College in Pennsylvania. This is Larry, a student at Colorado University, Boulder, Colorado, and like all of the Jenks family, very self-sufficient. Paul is 15. He'll be in 10th grade this year. And he is an avid baseball fan. Not only a fan, but a player. And so is Jim. He was Morrisville Eaton's pitcher this year and was valedictorian of his senior class. A typical family? Not quite. Until 4 years ago, Mary Jenks hadn't ever seen Susan or Jim or Paul, and Philip and Larry were only dim memories. She had lost her vision. Both she and her family faced that problem courageously. Then in 1966, she was a partner in a miracle. A corneal graft restored her sight, and what only had been a texture became a color again. She told Gene Doherty about that world of blindness, a world not black, but white.
My vision was white. It was I call it a wax paper vision. It was like looking through a frosted window pane. And I think if you put a piece of wax paper in front of your eyes like this and tried to look around, you would see just what it is, really. It's pretty close as far as I can tell.
When did that problem first develop?
It started when I was 16, and lasted for 20 years until I had my graft. It was a gradual disappearance of the vision.
I know when I read the article about it, in one sense you didn't know to what degree it was going, I think.
No, when I first went to the eye doctor, all I saw were a lot of spots. And gradually the spots began to become thicker and thicker. This is macular dystrophy. And until it covered the whole cornea. And well, through the years it just got whiter and whiter, and as the spots multiplied, there was no space left between the spots.
I know, too, from that article that you didn't waste time just bemoaning your fate. You were always active, weren't you?
Oh, very much so. I've had 5 children, and well, I bowled up until the last. I caught the last, but as long as you can hear, you can bowl. You can hear where the ball drops. And, oh, I even played bridge with a little help from my friends, and magnifying glasses and big cards.
And built houses.
And built houses. I built 4 houses. There's just so many things that you can do, really, if people give you a chance when you are blind. I think this is what we have to correct, is the visual-minded people, that their attitudes towards the blind people, that they can't do anything because they can't see.
What were the steps that led to the operation? How did you come to this decision, or how did you know it was going to be?
Well, things were getting pretty black. Even when you stayed inside, it was black. And I happened to meet Mr. Jerva at a glaucoma clinic, and he was telling me about the work that they're doing in Syracuse now. And well, this perked me up, because I would rather stay near home when I did have 5 children, so that they could come in to see me. And so he told me about the wonderful work that they were doing right here in Syracuse, so I decided to go and find a doctor.
She found a doctor, Dr. William V. Delaney. Partners in Miracles. That was the name Mrs. Jenks gave the article she wrote. Her story told about the doctor, the Lions Club Eye Bank, and her own family, because they too played a vital role.
Well, your orders are to come home and don't walk or talk. Or you can walk and talk, but nothing else. And or you're not to bend over or lift anything heavier in your shoe. As I said in my article, my kids wished I had a heavier shoe so that they wouldn't have to do so much picking up. But they learned how to cook, and they learned how to clean, and they took right over and kept everything done that I thought should be done. I think they were a little afraid, you know, that I might do something after I'd been in the hospital to injure myself.
What were your reactions when you could see again?
Well, that was quite a reaction. I had been to the doctor, and of course my eye had been bandaged for about 6 weeks, and I'd had the stitches removed that day. And he told me I could take the rest of the bandage off after I'd been home. And I sat down to have a cup of coffee. And I looked at that cup of coffee, and the coffee was so black, and the cup was so white, that I just couldn't believe what I was seeing. Actually, I think this was the first thing that came to me, that actually I could see that. I really don't know whether I thought I would be able to see or not, but all of a sudden it just came. And I started walking through the house and to see the different colors in the house. And well, my whole house just changed. I think my vision came back about 2 to 3 inches at a time. In other words, I could focus everything up close like this at first. And each day it would go 2 to 3 inches farther away. And I could almost see my line of vision grow as each day passed.
You have 5 children. Had you seen those children before the operation?
Well, I probably had seen the first 2 when they were babies. But by the time the 3rd one came along, he was beginning to get a little bit blurry. And I don't have much recollection of the 4th and 5th one, of what they looked like when they were babies.
Did your children look as you had imagined they would look?
Bobby, it's hard to say because I got to know them as voices and as silhouettes when all of a sudden they had noses and eyes. And it was just fascinating just to look at them and see what color eyes they had and try to get acquainted with them as human beings rather than silhouettes. It's difficult to explain that, I would think.
Difficult to explain, but then how could anyone put into words what it's like to see one's grown children for the first time? But Mrs. Jenks had no trouble telling us how vital she considers the Lions Club projects to conserve and restore sight.
Oh, I think it's very vital because it means so much to anyone. I can only speak for my side of it. It takes some courage for the patient to decide to have a transplant. But then you think it's either this or else, and you feel that you're taking a chance a little bit, but then when it does turn out like mine has, you just can't describe the possibilities that are available to you. I don't know, I feel as if I've been born again almost, because you get used to living in a certain way. And then all of a sudden you can see and all the opportunities that are available to you. You want to do so much more, and there's so much more you can do. And I think probably I irk my family a little bit because I want to do too much.
She wants to help someone else. There is a Lions Club theory that any action is like a pebble in a pond. The good spreads and spreads. Mary Jenks' sight has been restored. Her life has been changed, and she will change other lives. She is studying nursing at the college in Morrisville. She talked about that decision.
This is mainly why I took up nursing, is because I feel that I can relate to people who do have handicaps. And it doesn't make much difference what type of handicap, but I think I can relate to them as to their feelings. Most of these things have a lot to do with self-esteem. And if you can help them feel that their life is worthwhile, even though they're disabled, I think this is important, too. And I feel that I know a little bit about how they feel inside. So I find that it does work. I've worked with a lot of patients this year, and I've worked with quadriplegics and many different types. And I feel that just having one type of a handicap helps me to understand other people's feelings. So I'm looking forward to helping people through my experience, I hope, anyhow.
The mission of Mary Jenks, to help people. It's interesting that her miracle started at a glaucoma clinic while her husband was working to help someone else.
There is a brotherhood of man, a benevolent brotherhood of man, a noble tie that binds all human hearts and minds into one brotherhood of man. Your lifelong membership is free. Keep forgiving each brother all you can. Oh, aren't you proud to be in that fraternity, the great big brotherhood of man.
We're
in
the brotherhood of man, dedicated to giving all we can.
Oh, aren't you proud to be in that fraternity, the great big brotherhood.